So it's a big jump from the lead mines of the Yorkshire Dales to this place. This is the heavy machine shop at Forgemasters International in Sheffield. And we've been invited in here today by Gareth Barker, who's the managing director of the Forge division.
Well, first of all, can you just explain what's happening in here?
So this is our large heavy machine shop. So this has been here about 4 years now. And it has on our extra ultra large end, so we can lift up to 500 tons in here. And this was geared towards our large castings. And we can pour up to 600, 650 tons of molten steel and finish is about 350 tons. And I think if you put it into context, I think a double-decker bus is nominally 10 tons, I think. So if you imagine the size and scale of some of the things we're doing in terms of weight, it's enormous. We are still one of the biggest world leading in castings in terms of the size and in forgings. Again, in Western Europe, we are probably the largest, and in the world, again, we're up there amongst some of the other big ones.
And surprisingly, you managed to do this with quite a small number of workers.
Yeah, we have about 800 now on site, turning out. Peak production is about 100,000 tonnes a year of steel, which if you went back 30, 40 years ago, there was 25, 30,000 people working on a similar size site, outputting slightly less than what we do now. So it shows where the technology in terms of the infrastructure and the capital equipment that's in place now and the people, that as things have moved forward, there has been an advancement on how we output and what we can output based on how many people we need.
But how big are you by comparison with the steel industry elsewhere in the world?
Forgemasters, in terms of bulk steel, is pretty small, unfortunately. I think if you measured our tons output against some of the big dominances around the world, we probably wouldn't even get on their radar in terms of what we output. I mean, they're talking millions of tons of steel output, and we're 100,000 tons.
And what are the sort of applications for the products in here? Where are they going to go? Where are they going to be used?
We operate in various markets. We operate in specifically at the moment in offshore. So that's either subsea down on the production on the seabed. We also operate on the top side, part of the platforms, safety critical components, construction side of the platform and the lifting of the platform. We're then on power generation, which is traditionally at Forgemasters, we've made a lot of gas and steam turbine rotors. The nuclear side, civil, and the defence nuclear, and other defence related industries.
Well, that's what's happening now, but can I take you back to the year 1805, when I suppose it really all began on this site and sites round here in Sheffield. And what was happening in iron and steel then?
In 1805, this is where we started, and a lot of the steel industry started in Sheffield, so it's part from the when the Bessemer converter started and moving forward and through some quite big leaps in technology as you can.
It was a chap called Harry Brearley, wasn't it, who invented the process of stainless steel. Now, what difference did that make?
I think stainless is one of the biggest advancements in steel in the last 200 years. Probably from the early conception of normal carbon steel to probably the next biggest is stainless steel. Harry Brearley, 100 years ago, invented it by trying to make a steel which was less corrosive, but made a steel which was not corrosive. Neither did it tarnish. Neither did it have a metallic taste, which most steels do. And that's kind of where the cutlery industry then got hold of stainless, and Sheffield again on the back of its cutlery making skills, which is steeped in history and silver, then moved towards the stainless side of it.
But I mean, the stainless steel application wasn't only for cutlery. I mean, it's still presumably an essential part of what you do.
It is, yeah. Stainless now has moved on from its original, which was, when Harry originally invented it was quite difficult to work with. It was quite soft and was difficult to engineer in terms of normal cutting and everything else. So as that's progressed through the years, it's now you can see it in a nuclear reactor, in a safety critical offshore pieces, in power turbines, high temperature rotors are made from a stainless type derivative, and it's all on back of Harry Brearley's invention 100 years ago.
I suppose terrible global disaster that it was, though, the First World War would have been good for a place like this in terms of the demands for armaments.
Yep, at both World Wars, in World War I and World War II, the the amount of people who worked here, and a lot of the defence and some real critical pieces were made in Sheffield and were made in the mills in the Lower Down Valley region, be it plate, be it gun barrels, armaments, everything. Ammunition was also made on this site. So it was critical to our defence in World War I and World War II.
And to our survival, really.
Exactly, to where we are today.
But you were telling me earlier, sort of one of the ironies is at one time you'd be producing one part of the factory.
Yeah.
Armour plate.
A famous story which goes back is that one side of the business made impenetrable armour plating, and the other side of the business made armour-piercing ammunition, which could pierce any armour-plating, which is is a bit of an irony.
But your own personal story is quite an interesting one. I mean, you started working here on the shop floor at the age of 17, and now you're the managing director.
Yeah, so I started as an apprentice about 17, and I fell into engineering, I should say, through my father telling me that would be a good career. And if I'm honest, I didn't really know much about engineering.
But you do now.
So yeah, well, hopefully, yeah. So I started at 17 on shop floor, was in the machine shops, and then moved through various different production jobs, and then got into management at 23, 24. I was lucky to become the youngest director in the history of Forgemasters at 29, no, at 30, sorry, and then managing director at 35. So quite a quick rise, but
you're still very
one.
Hands-on.
Yeah, very hands-on.
You haven't disappeared into the boardroom.
No, not yet. Anyway, I still get involved in trying to see what's happening out there. It's exciting. It's nice to see and get back involved with lads. And there's always an engineering challenge, be it on production, be it on maintenance. There's always something going on which everybody's always involved. And if you want to have a look, if you think you've got something to say, so everybody's always engaged. So it's always good to get out and have a walk around and see what's happening.
Well, let me ask you finally, we've talked about what's happened here since the year 1805. What about the future? I mean, how do things look, for the future security of this business and sort of areas in which you'll be operating?
We're all about big forgings, big castings and machining and treatments and everything in terms of a quality product.
And the determination to keep ahead on the technology front, do you think it's that which is going to make sure you survive, even though in terms of volume you're a small operator by comparison to the Chinese?
Yep, I think that's exactly where we are. While ever we will keep in front of technology, while ever we keep pushing technologies forward and keep advancing at the rate that we are advancing at in terms of our technology side, we will stay ahead of the game. We will be the business that some of the main players need to come to because of our quality and because of our capabilities that we can offer, which are diverse from everybody else.
Darren, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.